Hey, so this is always a tough thing, right? What should you eat and what should you not eat? Well, I'm here to tell you, if you have prostate cancer or have worried about prostate cancer because a family member has had it, you have got to watch this next video.
All right, so it's tough. Some doctors are telling you to eat as much meat as possible, and others are telling you that it's really bad for you. But what if I told you that if you have a family history of prostate cancer, or if you have prostate cancer, it becomes very clear what you should and what you should not eat. Now, although PSA has actually become the worldwide marker for prostate cancer, that's all anyone wants to talk about, I actually want to introduce you to an amino acid that you've never probably heard of, but once we go through and I tell you more about it, you'll see that it becomes the key ingredient in the recipe of what you, as a person who either has prostate cancer or has a strong family history of prostate cancer, actually should and should not be eating. This is always the first question anyone should ask if you're worried about either getting a disease or getting rid of the disease. And it's always, what should I eat and what should I not eat? And up until this point, the media and the science has been very vague about what you should or should not eat when you have the diagnosis of prostate cancer, and it's either a reality or a fear. So research clearly points to the fact that prostate cancer incident and mortality rates are highest for African Americans. And the highest mortality rate worldwide is actually seen in men of African descent. And the lowest rate of prostate cancer death has actually been recorded in Asian men. Now, your prostate cancer prevention and annihilation diet, let's just call it that, can all be traced back to something called insulin-like growth factor 1, or IGF-1. Now, IGF-1 is a basic lab that can be ordered from any lab. And depending on the company and the panel, it costs anywhere from $75 to $300 to run the test. And it's actually commonly seen and ordered within the anti-aging panels, because insulin-like growth factor 1, or IGF-1, is a single peptide hormone that's made up of 70 different amino acids, and half of its structure looks very similar to that of insulin. So basically, it is known as a compound that helps grow muscle and strong bones. So it's traditionally thought of as a good thing. It's primarily produced in the liver, and the production of IGF-1 is actually stimulated by something called growth hormone. And it has been used for years as a marker of growth hormone activity. And once IGF-1 has been released into the liver, it then travels throughout the body to latch on to receptors that are found on the surface of cells and throughout the body. In fact, these receptors are found on healthy, normal prostate tissue, and it's also found in cancerous areas as well. So once IGF-1 actually finds its receptor and binds to it, it becomes activated. Now it's able to send out signals to tell cells what exactly to do. Now, this is where I want you to really start paying attention, because we're going to talk about how IGF-1 is going to dictate your diet if you have a strong family history of prostate cancer, or if you actually have prostate cancer. Now, you can almost think of IGF-1 as kind of like they're practicing in mind control. It actually starts to tell the cells whether they should live, whether the cells should die, whether the cells should grow, or whether they should replicate. It actually can even get into the nucleus or the central area of the cell and actually reprogram the DNA there. And it could tell it to do some great stuff, or it could tell it to do some really bad stuff. And in prospective cohort studies, these are studies that actually follow groups of people over time to look at health outcomes, and Mendelian randomization studies, which are actually studies that use genetics to look at whether levels of a substance found naturally within the body could actually be linked to a disease, the results are very, very clear. Now, listen to me. People who have higher circulating levels of IGF-1 concentrations within their bodies have a higher risk of breast cancer, of colorectal cancer, and prostate cancer. So if you have a family history of any of that, you really have to listen. You got to think about this video, and then I want you to share it. Because since the early 2000s, multiple studies have clearly shown that IGF-1 signaling is very closely related to the development and the progression of prostate cancer. So prostate cancer affects millions of men globally, and approximately 20% of these prostate cancer patients are found after they have developed a lethal or metastatic or hormone-resistant prostate cancer, all really terrible forms to have. And high levels of insulin-like growth factor 1 have been found in the prostate in these really resistant, malignant, terrible forms of prostate cancer. So as we go through this, I'm actually going to tell you how you can use your diet to actually reduce levels of IGF-1, all right? So the way that this works with prostate cancer in particular, or any cancer actually, is that going on within the body, there's kind of this balance that has to happen between the cancer cells multiplying and growing and these cells actually being programmed to die through a process called apoptosis. So you want apoptosis, you want your body to know, hey, these cells are bad, let's kill them off, right? But when the balance of this process is tilted towards less cell death and more cancer cell survival, this is how prostate cancer starts and it actually progresses. See, the body is designed to take cancer cells and be like, whoa, that's not supposed to be here. Let's get rid of it and get it out of here and program it to die and boom. But when that balance is off, now we have a cancerous situation that can start to grow and progress and spread. So IGF-1 signaling actually promotes the survival and the renewal and the spread of prostate cancer. So it becomes like, well, how do we reduce levels of IGF-1, right? It also promotes the resistance to prostate cancer treatments like radiation. One of the big things with prostate cancer is blocking testosterone. Well, now IGF-1 can actually signal, hey, that's not going to work. Program it so that none of that is really going to make a change. So it's almost like IGF-1 becomes a conductor in a cancer symphony. So much so that scientists have created treatments that are designed to target IGF-1 and its receptors in order to limit cancer development. Yes, it's that big of a deal. That's the big spin in prostate cancer right now, is how do you limit IGF-1? How can you reduce it? But the cool thing about it is you can actually reduce IGF-1 through your diet. So what this is saying is that when that IGF-1 level is elevated, guys are 4.5 times at a greater risk of developing prostate cancer than if they didn't. So now you know that getting IGF-1 levels lower, if you have prostate cancer, or if you have a high risk of developing a prostate cancer because your dad or your brother did, then you've got to really think about, how can I reduce this? So, of course, this leads us back to the original question of when you have prostate cancer in the family and when you've been diagnosed with prostate cancer, what should you eat? And the answer is that you should cut out meat as much as possible and go plant-based. I've said it. Now, this is contrary to what all the doctors on Instagram and all the doctors on YouTube are telling you. They say, eat more meat, get stronger. Meat is good for you. Meat is good for you. And I'm here to tell you that meat is great for a lot of people. But if you are worried about developing prostate cancer or you have it, meat is not your friend. And here's why. Let's take a look at a study from 2014 that was published in the Journal of Cell Metabolism. This study looked at the link between protein in the diet and mortality, protein in the diet and death. And they looked at the dietary habits of over 6,000 men and women from the United States between the ages of 50 and 65. And those that reported having high animal protein intake actually had a 4 times increase in cancer deaths during the 18 years that they followed up with these people. Interestingly enough, these cancer deaths seem to be non-existent if they ate protein from plants and not animals. Yes. Now, this is a completely different conversation than when we're talking about just erectile function, just the basics of testosterone. We are talking about prostate cancer and prostate cancer risk. And right now, we're actually talking about cancer in general. In fact, the study actually found exactly what the title of it is. Low protein intake is associated with a major reduction in IGF-1, cancer, and overall mortality in the 65 and younger group, but not in the older population. And what the study actually found is that eating animal protein when you're older than 65 seems to be okay and it doesn't seem to contribute. But when you're eating it in that group between 50 and 65, it tends to increase IGF-1, this thing that we've been talking about that's linked with an increase in a 4.5-fold increase in prostate cancer and an increase in the terrible forms of prostate cancer, an increase in overall cancer and overall mortality. So people, get this, with chronically low levels of IGF-1, this thing we've been talking about this whole time, insulin-like growth factor 1, typically they may be a little chubbier, they may be a little fatter, because remember, IGF-1 helps build strong muscle and strong bone, but they found that people that have those low levels of IGF-1 typically don't die of cancer. I'll say that again. When the levels of IGF-1, insulin, like growth factor 1, they typically don't die of cancer. So it became clear, and it becomes really clear, that if you have a strong family history of cancer, animal protein could in fact be a huge enemy. So look at this. In the UK, they took 11,815 male and female participants, and they completed a 24-hour dietary assessment. And their IGF levels were measured before and after, 24 hours after they ate and did their thing. And what they found is that circulating levels of IGF-1 went up in people who ate animal protein and milk protein, right? So that's another study. Another one, 40,000 men followed for 30 years. And every 4 years, they updated their food information. And what they found on these 40,000 men, so what they found is that the men who ate the most plant foods had 20% lower risk of fatal forms of prostate cancer. What that means is that 20% of them had a lower risk of that worst form of prostate cancer, the one that doesn't respond to any treatment, the one that metastasized, that moves to the body, to the bone, to the brain. The men who were young with earlier onset prostate cancer seemed protective of the fatal forms of prostate cancer if they had a high plant-based diet. So I want you to keep in mind and to know this, that there is a cancer triad. There is a prostate cancer triad. A high meat diet, physical inactivity, so not moving around, and belly fat, visceral fat. This triad causes an increase in insulin release and an increase in inflammation. And so what you want to focus on is a diet that is not inflammatory and that is not pro-insulin release, that is not causing a lot of insulin release. So I'm going to put this up on the screen and show you that the foods you want to eat less of to decrease inflammation, you want to eat less red meat, you want to eat less processed meat, you want to eat less starchy veggies like potatoes, you want to eat less, drink less sugary drinks, and you want to get off the refined grains. You also, in order to decrease that insulin release, the butter, the eggs, and chicken, and turkey, and non-fatty fish. Right? Chicken and turkey. We've been saying chicken and turkey's fine. Lean cuts of meat. How many people do you know that say, oh, I don't eat red meat anymore, I just eat chicken and turkey? Well, guess what? Chicken and turkey are pro-insulin releasing, and they will increase the level of IGF-1 in your body. So you want to eat, but you can eat more of these. Eat foods that decrease inflammation and decrease insulin release. And these are going to be your non-starchy vegetables. These are going to be all of the stuff that we have in the smoothie recipes, right? This is why our smoothie recipes, this is why guys are having such great results with them. They're lowering IGF-1. They are lowering insulin release, right? They are anti-inflammatory instead of being pro-inflammatory, right? You can eat fruit. You can drink coffee, and you can even drink alcohol in moderation. So it leaves you a lot of things, but if you have been diagnosed with prostate cancer, or if your dad had prostate cancer, your brother had prostate cancer, you gotta lay back on the meat.
So now you know. If you're worried about prostate cancer, have prostate cancer, have a family history of prostate cancer, your protein needs to come from things like this and beans. And less from the chicken, the eggs, the milk, the beef. All right? Catch me on my next video.